Amen. And so we are blessed that the Lord is giving us his favor. How many of you are just glad and happy to be saved in this hour today? I'm just so glad to be saved and living for the Lord. We are going to continue in our Focus on the Family series and what we've been dealing with in reference to marriage. We're going all the way back to the beginning and breaking down some philosophies and some concepts that have been misconstrued and misinterpreted according to God's word. And you know, that's why the Bible says, study to show yourself approved, a good worker that needeth not be ashamed, rightly divide the word of truth. And when you begin to dig into the word of God, you will just find some amazing things that God wants to share with you. And so we are just blessed to have God's word as a map and a light to our pathway, guiding us into holier living. Amen. And so we want to continue on with our lesson. We're going to be talking tonight, praise God, on a biblical basis for equal partnership. I was praying, asked the Lord today. I was planning on going down one route. I was going to be coming out of the Word of God. And I know I had said on last week after Apostle Eugene had taught in reference to me teaching on some things in reference to going through the Word of God and showing different women that were in ministry and the importance of equal partnership, not only in the marriage, but in the body of Christ, in order for us to come to full maturity, not only in our homes, but in the church. Because if you're not coming to full maturity in your home, you're definitely not coming to full maturity in the church. And that's the problem with a lot of people. They're trying to bring half into the church, and a half can't make a whole. It got to be everybody together as one in order to complete the body of Christ. It starts from the home first. Before, it don't start in the church. It starts in the family. And so if the family's broken, the church will be broken. And so that's what we have to understand. We got it backward, and we think we can come to church and try to get it together and have it and do all these things, and then our home is broke and we're not together in the home and we're not doing what we can do in our home and think we got it right here with the Lord, but that ain't how it worked. God instituted family first. And family, with the marriage, was the first establishment that God established in the very beginning. So if that's broke, everything else is going to be broke too. And so we're going to be dealing with a biblical basis, but I was going to be teaching on some different women in ministry, but then the Lord took me a different way, and I somehow incorporated it. I was able to kind of incorporate it. So we're going to incorporate it. I'm able to bring it from a foundation and then bring it up to where we are currently going to be going. But I want to read from the book of Ephesians chapter 4 from the Amplified Version. And it says, for because of him, the whole body, the church, in all its various parts, closely joined and firmly knit together by the joints and ligaments with which it is supplied. When each part, with power adapted to its need, is working properly and all its function grows to full maturity, building itself up in love. And what is that? And I like this particular version of it, how they worded it, because it's letting you know that every part of the body is fitly joined together. That it's not separate, it's not divided, it's not off by itself, but it's all joined together, adapted with power, adapted to its need. That means everybody in the body has a need. There's a need for you in the body. We're all joined together. We're not individuals. We're not separately. We're not divided. We're together. Okay, and when we're together, then it's working what? Properly in all its functions. So that means if somebody is missing, or a part is missing from the body, or you're trying to work without the foot is trying to work without the knee, some is not going to function right. Okay, that's how God created the body. That's how he created the family. And I thank God we're teaching this because we're breaking down all this philosophy that has come from Catholicism into the church, that has come from pagan worship, that has come from pagan beliefs and different ideologies into the church, and we've carried it into the church, and we've preached it, and we've taught, and we've oppressed part of the body, the women in the church, and that the body cannot function properly, it's not a whole, because everybody is not doing the part that they need to do. And so, and that's the only way that we're going to grow in maturity, in building itself up, the body building itself up in love, okay? And so that's how the body is built, okay? When everybody is in one accord, everybody's working for the same goal, everybody's focus, mind is one, everything is one, everything God do is about being one. One, not two, not divided, not hierarchy, not lower, higher, all one. That means everybody's equal, everybody's pushing for the same goal, everybody's going for the same, it has the same desire, everybody has the same mindset, okay? And that's in Ephesians 4. Next slide, Kendra. And we're going to talk about some things, a biblical base for equal partnership. We're going to cover the basic foundation of partnership, what the term Adam means, as well as woman and man, man and woman given equal responsibility. God differentiates man and woman. Misinterpretation of Genesis 2 and 23. The word help, ezer, we're gonna talk about that too. We're gonna break down help and meet, and we're gonna get a great understanding of really what help meet is. It's not what we have been taught. It is not what we have been taught. Meet with this connecto. We're going to clarify all that. Ezra connecto, and then women in ministry. We're going to go and end with women in ministry. I couldn't get everything I needed, so I might continue this next week. So we're gonna go and delve into some things that we always know where it goes back to. It starts in the very beginning. Kendra, the next slide. So those are just some topics that we are going to be going over tonight. The basic foundation of the partnership of women and men in God's creation in the church and its ministry is given in the open chapters of Genesis. And I kind of talked about it a bit back about turning, and I kind of hit on some areas there. Well, we went into what Tosha is, which means turning. When the woman turned away from God, turned her affections toward the man, then that's when things began to break down in between the husband and the wife, the relationship, when sin came in. So it begins in the book of Genesis. Everything has to go back to the beginning. You cannot get a good understanding without first going and getting an understanding of the beginning. Because the beginning is where the misinterpretation came in. The beginning is where people began to put their philosophy and their ideology in. The beginning is where people, pagan religions, came in and began to tell their own version of the story. And somehow it got engrafted, and we took it from generation to generation, and we just taught it because it was tradition. But nobody ever desired, or if they did, they knew, but because they were just doing it, they just kept on doing it because it was the norm. And nobody wanted to go against the grain. And so we see that you have to go back to the beginning. First man, Adam, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the meaning, term meaning. Adam is a generic term meaning human person or mankind. That's what Adam means. Earth, human, person, mankind. First man, that's all it is. Is created in God's own image according to Genesis 1, 26 through 27 and 5, 1 through 2. Now when you go look up Adam, you'll see some say earth, but when you go to the Youngs, and I'm gonna be giving you some different commentaries according to this, but you really have to study, okay? And to get the understanding and of man, and it's the term meaning mankind, earth, red. That's all. That's all Adam means. Okay. It wasn't a When God created Adam, he created him from the earth. He created him to represent all mankind. This creation in God's image includes the identification of persons as male and female. So when God made Adam, he made Adam as a representation of what? Male and female, mankind, okay? He didn't leave the woman out, he already had the woman on his mind. So Adam was gonna be a representation at the time for all of mankind, all of humanity that God was getting ready to bring into existence, okay? Which is the woman. So this creation of God's image includes the identification of persons as male and female. This mutuality of women and men carries no suggestion of male headship or female submission. When God created Adam, he did not create Adam, and he did not create Eve with the idea that man was going to rule over the woman. That was not God's intention. And nowhere in scripture, in the beginning, when you read the book of Genesis, do we see that at all, anywhere, period. When God created man and when he created woman, you don't see that. It was not a headship, it was not a dominance, but it was for them to be together in what? Companionship. And so the second thing that this mutuality is confirmed by the fact that both man and woman together are charged with responsibility for all of God's creation in Genesis 1, 26, and 20, verse 26 and verse 23. So God gave them the what? The command to be fruitful and multiply, replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over what? All the creatures and all the things that God created, over the fish of the sea, fowl of the air, over the tree, everything. He gave them both dominion, both co-partnership, both equal rulership, both. And we're gonna see as we go down through the scripture, he gave them both. They were both commanded to take care and do what they needed to do in the midst of the garden. And if anybody can show me something else other than that, I would like to see it. When God created man and woman, where he gave just the man the responsibility. Because when I read it, it says them. Okay, that means what? Both man and woman. All right, let's go to the next slide, Kendrick. This equal partnership between man and woman is also present in retelling of the creation story in Genesis chapter 2. Here the man is found in need of a companion, but none of the creatures God created qualified, did they not? No, they did. They didn't qualify. They didn't meet up to the standard in Genesis 2, 18 through 20. So God said, look, I created all these things, but none of them can quite compare to me. None of them are his equal. None of them have the intellect. None of them have the intelligence. None of them have the capacity to communicate with them. So none of them qualified to be in his category. Thus, God differentiates man and man, which is Adam, into man, which is Ish. Okay, Ish in the Hebrew, man. And woman, Isha, in Hebrew, which means woman. Persons of separate male and female gender. And when you look at man and woman, Ish and Isha, that's what they mean. Okay, God differentiates the man and the woman, the gender, with Ish and Isha. Okay? They're the only difference in there. I think God would go through so much to make provisions for Adam to have companionship is to relate the male and female persons as equal. So what did God do? God said, I'm going to differentiate man and woman. They're going to be, they are one, but they're going to have a difference. They're going to, this is going to be called man, and she's going to be called woman. Indicated by the common designation Ish and Isha, which comes from the same root word, as you can see. Okay? The only difference was one is I-S-H. The other difference is one is I-S-H, S-H-A-H. Okay? But they came from the exact same root word, Ish, because she came out of what? Man, okay? Which comes from the same root word, also the identity of bone and flesh in Genesis 2 and 23 was another indicator that what? She was bone of my bone and what? Flesh of my Wama Isha, from the root Ish. Okay, that means they were of the same, cut from the same cloth, made the same way. One was just taken out of the other. That's the only difference. Okay, so we see this is climax with the concept of, could you go to the next slide? Neutrality expressed in the one flesh term used in Genesis 2 and 24. So, Ish, Isha, one flesh, bone of my bone, is what? Is showing the neutrality, the expression that we are one. We are one. Term used in Genesis 2 and 24. They came from the same Hebrew Greek word. Ish, Isha, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. We're going somewhere. Stay with me. Don't go to sleep. Because this was very exciting to me. Hallelujah. We're excited about the word. Ish and Isha, same root word. Some have interpreted. I'm sorry for my misspelling. I had somebody proofread, but we didn't do a great job proofreading. Interpreted. I'm sorry. Some have interpreted Genesis 2 and 23, and this blew me away, in which the man Ish, Adam, man, called the bones of my bones and flesh of my flesh, woman, Isha, is an act of naming that demonstrates the headship or authority of man over woman. Now, what some people say is that at this particular verse, when you go back and read it, that Adam was naming the woman. Was he naming her? Was he naming her? Okay. How many of you think Adam was naming the woman? Okay, you said he was naming her the woman? How was he named?
He said, this is bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman.
Okay. Okay, I want you to hear what you said. Felicia?
Woman is more of a noun.
I'm glad you said that. Elder Darnell?
She wasn't named till later on.
Oh, glad you said that. We're going to get all the point. Okay, so Daquan, you said, and this is why I want to know, because we're going to help people get understanding. Okay? And Felicia said exactly, okay, he was not naming her. First of all, woman is not a name. Woman is a pronoun. Okay? If we've all taken English, woman is a proper noun. It is not a name. Period. So that philosophy that was instituted in the church when he said Adam was giving her a name is incorrect. He was not naming her. She was already named. When he said bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, God already has said she was going to be a woman. Okay, already. Adam was just reiterating what God had already said. He was just reiterating, she's woman, she's bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. He wasn't giving her a name, because woman is not a name. Just like Jehovah is not a name. Just like Jehovah Jireh is not a name, is it?
No.
Jehovah Rapha is not a name, is it? Okay? Jehovah Tiskanu is not a name, is it? No. It is a pronoun, proper noun. You got to go back to English, okay? So he was not naming her, but we have been taught. I mean, we were taught that he named the woman. He named her in this particular verse. How many were taught that? I was taught that. When he said, bone of my bones, she shall be called woman. He was giving her name. That means God made him head over her. But he wasn't giving her name. He was just stating a fact. She was bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. She's woman, and she was taken out of me. That's all he was doing. Okay? And then it says, however, Isha, woman, is not given a name until after, which brings up what Elder Christian said, Darnell said. After the fall, when Ish, man, is when Adam named his wife Eve. In the book of Genesis 3 and 20, he did not name her until after the seed. He was not given the authority to name her before the seed. Because he was not given dominion over her before the seed. Okay? We got to follow of earth. Man, woman, humankind, per people, okay? But Eve was not given a name unto, the woman was not given a name until after the fall of mankind, after sin entered in, okay? So man, this scripture here is not showing a hierarchy or dominance because he said she's bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, she shall be called woman. He was making a statement because God had already said it's going to be a woman, okay? And what verse was that in? In verse 22, God had already stated that. And I remember when I looked at that, I said, honey, if you look at this, you'll see where God said woman in 22, and then you go down and you see where Adam repeats the same thing. He's just saying, she's of me, she's woman, she's made. 23, I'm not looking at it. So which one is it in, 22,
23? Both verses,
actually.
22 and 23.
Okay, so it is in both. Well, I know it was in two of them, but I'm not looking at it right now. Let me go there very quickly on my phone. But when you see that, you see that it is not a name. Okay. It is not a name. It is a proper what? Like Felicia said. 2 and 22, correct? Okay, so we see it says, and the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now what? Bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of me. So he's letting you know, he's making a statement. God in 22, the Lord already said she's going to be called woman. And then in 23, Adam was saying, she's going to be called woman because she was taken from me. That's all he was doing. He was not naming her. Okay? Genesis 2 indicates that the woman partner with man will be an appropriate helper in Genesis 2 and 18. And we go to the next slide. Okay? 2 and 18. Let's go back up to 2 and 18. It says, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him and help me for him. Okay, now this is where we run into the problem. First of all, they say Adam named the woman. Woman, he didn't. Okay, she didn't get a name until we saw in Genesis 3, 20, until after the fall of mankind. And then this is where we run into a problem. It was not good that man should be alone. Man needed a counterpart, someone to complement him physically. Okay? The animal could do it. Somebody to complement him intellectually and spiritually. And he said, I will make a help fit for him, or I will make a helper meet for him. Now, I got that little excerpt from the Unger's commentary on the Old Testament. Now, when you read the Unger's commentary, it states that about the word help meet. It says meet, says fit, okay, for him. So in other words, God, when he said, I will make him a help meet, he said, I'm going to make him somebody that's going to be on his spiritual level, somebody that's going to be fit to communicate with him, somebody that's going to have the same intellect, and somebody that's going to be physically in the same image. Right. Okay? That's all he was saying. He wasn't saying, I'm making you a, uh-huh. I'm making you somebody that's going to be up under you. He said, I'm making somebody that's going to be fit just like you. Somebody that's going to look like you, act like you, talk like you, be able to communicate what you have, the intellect you have. Right. On the same level. Woman got a brain just like a man. Woman has the same intellect God has just like the man. Why? Because Ish and Isha were cut from the same piece of cloth. They were both made to be one. They were both made with the mind of Christ.
Right.
Okay? Before the fall. The word help or helper comes from a Hebrew word ezer. Mm-hmm. When used of a person in the Old Testament, now this was really something to me. Because when I went to the Blue Letter Bible and I looked up this definition of help, it had ezer. And in that definition text, it said support. Okay? And I said, where did they get the word support? I couldn't understand it. Couldn't fathom it around my mind. I said, now, Lord, I know this word ezer does not mean support in no way, form, or fashion. So the Lord said, now, you got all them study books he in your closet. You know, run on in there, because I've been using some, it's all kind of access on the internet. You can get to different commentaries and all these kind of things, dictionaries. And so I've been on there, so I said, go to your closet and pull out your Young's Analytical Dictionary. So I went to my closet and pulled out my Young's Analytical Dictionary. Very great dictionary. Great, love it. And pulled it out and began to read through it. And not one time did I see in the Old Testament where the word Ezra was ever used as a support. Uh-huh. But when I went to the term in the New Testament in Greek, okay, in the New Testament in the Greek, then it was translated support. Okay. So I said, now how are you going to get Ezra from the Old Testament to mean what it means in Greek in the New Testament? Totally different translation, totally different dialect, totally different language, totally different people. So the words that they used meant something different than what the Hebrew word Ezra in the Old Testament meant at the time the word of God was being written. And so I look all through Old Testament meant all what it meant. Okay, we're going to get to that. And so in the Old Testament, Ezra, when used of a person in the Old Testament, always refers to God. God. In 29 places in Scripture, apart from one reference to David in 1 Chronicles 12 and 18, the word Ezra always represented God. Do you hear me? God. Help meant God. Ezra, God. 29 scriptures in the Old Testament. The word Ezra means help, God. Okay? 1 Chronicles 12 and 18 was the only reference where Ezra was used in reference to King David. When it says, thine are we. In other words, it said, we are yours, David. Peace be to thine helpers. In other words, peace be to all those that are with you, David. Your helpers. We are your helpers, David. That was the only time Ezra was not used in reference to God. In this particular verse here. But now, in this, it was in there, but on this particular, these particular two times where it was mentioned, in this one verse, helper, help, we are thine, peace be unto thine helpers, that particular Ezra does not, it's not referencing to God. But when it says, for thy God helpeth, okay, for thy God helpeth, Ezra, that's in reference to God, thee. In no sense can God be understood as being subordinate to the will or direction of David. When they said help Ezra, that don't mean God was subordinate to David, but that was meaning God was his help. It does not mean he was under subjected to David, because God cannot be subjected to man. So when they use the word Ezra here, was it saying, okay, God, because you're helping David, you're in subordination to David? Because you're supporting him? Because you're taking care of him? You are subordinate to him? You are underneath him? No, it doesn't. It's the same exact word used in the book of Genesis when it said, help me, Ezra. Okay? Ezra.
Just from sitting here and looking at this, I'm sitting here thinking about it. If God wanted Adam to have somebody that he would have dominion over, then he already had dominion over everything else. Why was everything else not suffice? It was not suffice because God didn't want Adam to have somebody that he was going to be over. Because exactly. If that was the case, he could have used anything else that he already had dominion over. So that just says right there that God didn't want him to have a meat that he had dominion over because he could have used anything else. That's why there was Eve. That's why there was Eve, because that's why they were equal, because God didn't want him to have somebody with him that he had rule and dominion over, because anything else would have sufficed for that.
Amen. So we're going to see, we're going to go on, but we're not going to take any more questions after we complete, okay? And okay, and you're exactly right, and we're gonna get into that. It says, in no sense can God be understood as being subordinate to the will or direction of David. Ezer, Hebrew, means rescuer, strength, help, deliverer, power, to make strong, to save, support. But it's not a support in the way you're under me. That's not what it's meaning. It means I'm supporting you, I'm helping you to stay strong. If Elder Daquan was in trouble, Elder Darnell was gonna help support him by doing what? Coming to his aid, coming to assist him in battle. When you are supporting somebody, are you supporting to them? No! What are you doing? You're helping them. You're trying to help deliver them. You're trying to help save them. Y'all are working together to do what? Make it out together. That don't mean I'm supporting. Elder Daquan is supporting it to Jonathan because Jonathan is supporting him, or Jonathan is supporting it to Elder Daquan because he is helping support Elder Daquan in time of crisis or in time of need or whatever you're doing. That don't mean you're supporting that you're over your hierarchy or you're over dominion or anything like that. No. But the Young's analytical concordance to the Bible, when you go and look in it, it tells you all and has a whole bunch more. Whole bunch. Support, strength, help, deliver, power to make strong. So in other words, Eve made Adam strong. Eve helped deliver Adam from what? From loneliness. Eve rescued Adam from being all by himself. Why? Because God saw that it was not good that man should be alone. So God sent him some what? Support. Come on, somebody. He sent him a deliverer. Somebody help deliver him from his loneliness. From being by himself. Someone to help give him what? Strength.
Carry the load.
To help carry the load. To help bear the burden. To help take responsibility. Because he couldn't do it what? All by himself. Okay? He couldn't do it. Ezer means rescuer, strength, deliverer, help, power, to make strong, to save, and to support. In the way that you are equal in partnership together as one. Go to the next slide, Kim, for me. And we see as it was used in the Old Testament, Ezra, it did not imply superiority or subordination on the part of the one giving or receiving assistance. That ain't what it meant. Just because I was receiving assistance don't mean I was subordinate under you. But just because you were receiving assistance don't mean you were supporting it under that person. That's not what Ezra was talking about. Ezra was just saying God sent you some help from the sanctuary. Somebody that you can communicate, talk to, be with. Somebody can help you in hard times and lift you up when you were weak. You can lift them up when they were down. You support one another. The word Ezra, helper, denotes not domesticity or subordination, but competency and superior strength. That's what Ezra meant, competency and superior strength. Here are some examples. Somebody give me Exodus 18:4.
Exodus.
Somebody give Deuteronomy 33:26. Now, these are just some examples of how Ezra is used when it comes to God. And it's used in the same text as what he said, help, when he was referring to Eve, the woman. If you have 18:4.
Exodus. And the name of the other was Eleazar, for the God of my father said he was mine help and delivered me from the sword of Pharaoh.
Okay, now who is that talking about?
God.
It's talking about who?
God.
He is your what?
Help.
Your help. Somebody get Deuteronomy 33:26. That word is ever. Ever. Deuteronomy when God said, I'm going to give you a help, he said, I'm going to give, he said, I, God, am going to give you somebody that's going to be your help, your support, your strength, your rescue, your deliverer. From what? From you being all alone by yourself. Because in her, you're going to see me. You're going to see a reflection, okay, of yourself. You're going to see my image because we're made in whose image? God's image. So now Adam was able to see a reflection of God through who? The Isha. Was God going to dominate his own self? He made man in his image, and he's going to have man dominate over his own image? Come on, somebody. And this gives you examples. Psalms 33 and 20, Psalms 70 and 5, Psalms 121 and 1 are just some examples of where the word answer is used as help in reference to God. The Hebrew word connecto is the modifier of answer, which is meet, in Genesis 2 and 18, meaning Eve is corresponding to him who, Adam, ish, or equivalent. That means she was equivalent to who Adam was. His help, meet, connecto, comes from the word neg, and from the Strong's number 5048. The Hebrew lexicon Brown, Driver, and Briggs, the DBDB, gives the primary meaning of neg as in front of, in sight of, or opposite to. Who was in front of Adam? Who was in the sight of Adam or opposite to Adam? The woman. Because when Adam looked at her, he saw who? Himself. Which is made in the who? Image of Christ. Okay? So they saw a reflection of God in one another. Okay? In the sight of or opposite to. Can you go to the next slide? It says, but the word in verse 18 and 20 isn't simply neg. It has both a prefix and a suffix. And that is supposed to be a space between has both. The K-A-F prefix is an inseparable preposition which typically translated as like, as, and according to the suffix, which we're talking about connecto. The suffix is equivalent to the pronoun him. Him. So the word connecto is effectively made up of two prepositions plus a pronoun and can be called a prepositional phrase. Now, does anybody know what a prepositional phrase does in English? What does a prepositional phrase do?
Well, a prepositional phrase is just kind of like an added part to clarify something.
Exactly. Okay, and add a part. So she was a what clarification of who what Adam was of himself. Okay, a clarification. God was giving him somebody who can clarify. When he looked at her, he saw himself standing right in front of him, right beside him. Okay. Commentary, dictionary, goes on to give the definition of connecto as to what is in front of, according to, and it translates Genesis 2 and 18 as, I will make him a help corresponding to him, which be equal and adequate to himself. All he was doing was making a clarification of who Adam was looking at. You're looking at yourself, Adam. That's why he said, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she came out of me. She is me. We are one. When I look at her, I see my reflection in a mirror. So when you look at your wife, you see who? Yourself. When she look at you, she sees who? Herself. Why? Because we're both in the image of Christ. Okay? The Genesius Hebrew Chaldee lexicon, which you can find that particular version
on
on the Blue Letter Bible. Okay? But you can actually go, you go to the Blue Letter Bible, and on the, in between it has the little Genesis lexicon. When you click on it, you can click down, it has Hebrew words, Chaldean words, and all that. Then it besides it has little notations. But you can actually go to the internet too and type in Genesis lexicon, and you can pull it up and you can go right to it and start putting up words and give you definition all of them. Okay? But the Genesis Hebrew Charlie Lexicon notes that connecto is not found anywhere else in the Bible. Okay, except for that. Now the King James Version actually translates Ezra. Can you do the next slide? Okay, Dave, thank you. Translate Ezra connecto as a help meet for him. The King James Version translated right. Because it means meet, fit. That's what meet is. You know, you remember now how many, when we were being taught this, they put help me as one word.
Yes.
Come on, yes. come on, now let's be truthful. They did it. Help me, they made it one word. And it wasn't until God began to bring it up, and I said, Lord, that ain't one word, that's two. Mm-hmm. Where did I ever look like I see that before? They tried to make it one word, help me. Right. Go look through some of them and see. It's two words, two distinct words, meaning two distinct definitions. Mm-hmm. Okay, they don't mean the same thing. Okay, so meet, fit, connecto. Okay, so the King James Version translated it right, a help meet for him. But people have misunderstood help meet and translated it to mean this expression, that God made woman to serve or assist the man, or even be confined to subordinate or domestic role. Come on now.
Right.
Now that's what they say.
Right.
God wants you in the home. You're supposed to be doing your work. That's how come so many women trapped right now. I'm gonna help set us free. Oh my God. So the body can work and grow in maturity.
Right.
And work in the home and be docile and all this. Do whatever your husband says to do, and wah, 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 wah. And we've been trapped by that, because that's the biggest lie the devil's ever told, greatest lies ever told, to bring division and cause to stunt the growth of the body of Christ. Because when the body's not functioning at home, it can't grow. It cannot, it's strained. That's why the church is strained right now, struggling. God ain't the church either. Okay, so don't let I get it twisted. God ain't struggling. The folks in the church are struggling. God ain't struggling. Because God's going to find somebody he can flow through, and he's going to flow through them and use them and move on. And the ones that struggle because they bound up in their minds and their thoughts and they've been lied to because they're not searching God out for themselves, and they're lost and they're just wandering around. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know who I am in Christ. How come you guys think you got so many people walking around right now in the body of Christ, so many women that don't know what they're called to do? Because they put them in a box. And when the husband's called, what you understand is you are called. He called to preach and teach. You called to preach. Well, I'm not. I can't preach. Well, you ain't got to preach or teach. So they translate it as domestic, subordinate. Oh, you just be quiet. You sit around over there with your big pretty hat on, your long dress, and your hair done up in a bun, and you just sit there, and you just be, and you support me while I preach, and you just fan your with your fan and come in, look pretty. Don't break a sweat. Because you're not a servant of the Lord. You just sat here on the pew, filled with the Holy Ghost, just to sit here and look pretty. You ain't got no power. Because you called for domestic work. You can't lay hands on nobody but the women. Because only the women can be healed by your hand. A man can't. You can teach the women, because only a woman can learn from what you teach, because you're a woman, she's a woman. A man can't. For the last time I checked, the word of God is the word of God. I don't care who teaches, who preaches, who God gives the word through. It's the word of God. It's still power. It ain't about the vessel that's bringing it forth. It's about the word that's coming forth. The word of God is life. I'm not giving life. The word is.
Right.
Okay? So it has messed up a lot of things in the body of Christ. It messed up a lot of people because they want you to serve. you know, you've been taught that. All you do is teach Sunday school, tend to the children. How come the daddy can't tend to the children? Come on, daddies.
Well,
you and daddy, you laid down and had them. Let's help raise them. Okay? How come the daddy can't change the pepper? How come the daddy can't wash their baby? How come the daddy can't feed them? How come the daddy, come on now. We got this twisted. This is family. It is not just a woman's job to change no child's pamper. You had her. Did you not? It ain't the woman's job to put the child to bed. You and daddy, aren't you supposed to be? Y'all partners now. You laid down half together. You was partners then, wasn't you? You got to be partners all the way to the end. That's what Ezra means. You're going to support one another, help one another, deliver one another. You can't deliver yourself by yourself. You can't support yourself by yourself. You can't rescue yourself by yourself. Okay? So it's not just defined to a domestic role. A help suitable for him is what the Eastern Bible Dictionary said. A help suitable for him. Somebody that was suitable, fit, neat for Adam, man-ish. Not somebody that was subordinate. The word help meet or helper, this is not to be understood as an expression of submission and service to man. Rather, the woman as helper serves God with man. She serves God with man. The woman as helper serves God with man. That's what help me mean. Help me did not mean you're supporting. You come and sit down, put your makeup on, put your heels on, wear your big hat, and you come and sit down and you be quiet. You serve God with man. You serve God together. Okay? Surviving pagan views of women, man's philosophy, man's theology forced a supportive role for Eve, woman, Isha, into the interpretation of Genesis 2 and 18. This is where pagan views, pagan religion, Catholicism start forging all of these views about Eve, she was of the devil. Eve, it was her fault. Eve, no, the last time I checked, it was both their fault. Because once when he took this, said both of their eyes were open. Both of them came to an understanding. Together, why? Because they were one. They saw God as one. They heard God as one. And when they sinned, both of them sinned. And when they both disobeyed, then their eyes were open. Okay? And so we see that the survived pagan ideology and philosophy came in. And when you start really researching, look, you'll start seeing where a lot of this stuff was forged about Eve, and then it's like a little fairy tale, then all of a sudden it started infiltrating into the church. And then people start believing it. Then they start writing about it, start putting books out about it. They start changing the word of God. They start adjusting stuff to what they want to fit to help their ideology and philosophy be passed down as a truth. That's why God says, study to show yourself approved, a good worker that need not be ashamed, rather divide the word of truth. Why? Because he knew men were going to come in and be deceitful, crafty, yeah, and work their philosophy into the gospel, and you're going to have to know how to discern that. Right. Study. Know your word. Know what God says to you. Know that God can tell you. Now, see, I said it all the time, I couldn't prove it, but I just didn't ever believe it. They preached it, but I could never wrap my mind around it. I could never understand how God could make me in his image, but yet I'm under subordination of a man who was made in the same image, who have possessed the same power I possess, who obtained the same Holy Ghost I obtained, who has to go through the same redemptive blood I have to go through. How can he be over me? How can he save me? I never understood that. But it just wasn't my time that they had forgot to reveal it yet. But I was like, okay, God. So he said, philosophy crept in. And we know how philosophy go, creeps in, and next thing you know, they start altering. Next thing you know, it's passed off as the word of God. Wasn't that what they were doing in the Ephesian church and the Corinthian church? It was talking about Eve was made before Adam. And false doctrine, it goes on right now. And it's still going on with this doctrine that they've been preaching for all these centuries. And guess what? Paul had to put a stop to it. Guess what? God's time raising up people that's going to put a stop to this too. All this falseness lying and all this high art that no men may not like it, but showing this men that want to be dominated over a woman. But God didn't create you to dominate. He created you to be subordinate to your wife and she to you. You're not over, you're together. Some men may get fighting, but I've had men come to me, and I had to politely put them in love of Christ and put them in their place. Why? Because you are just like me. You're in God's image. I never had a problem with that. But what God had to teach me is how to do it in love. Not argue, but in love. Tell them the truth. In love. And so, if pagan views of women, man's philosophy, forced a subordinate role for Eve on women into the interpretation of Genesis 2 and 8, you want to know how that came about? That's how that came about. Because when you study and you go into studying the Word, you are not going to find it anywhere at all. Can you go to the next slide? There is not a hint, not even a whisper, about anything like a hierarchy or order existing between man and woman in the creation account. If it is, please show it to me. Please show it to me. And when you can show it and make it go line upon line, precept upon, I'm talking about line upon line, taking one scripture and using that scripture for the whole book of all the books of the Bible to base your philosophy and your doctrine off of. I'm talking about taking scripture and scripture after scripture and lining it up and showing me where he ever established that. Because I'm going to show you where he broke it down. Okay? It started after the fall, not before. Sin brought in the consequences of this. Okay? It caused us to turn away from God. It caused a divide in the family. It caused all kind of stuff to go on. It was not till after the sin that all this crept in. It was not before. Okay? So we see the creation order established oneness, not hierarchy, according to Genesis 2 and 24. The woman was instrumental in rescuing the man from being alone, therefore creating a community of oneness that God had intended to create with both of them according to Genesis 1 and 27. Somebody get 1 and 27. Somebody get Genesis 2 and 24. The biblical text becomes violated when the word helper is misconstrued and lifted out of its specific context. Who has Genesis 1 and 27?
1 and 27. Mm-hmm. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them.
Come on now. Come on. Who's he talking about?
Both of them.
He talking about them? Or who's he talking about? He's talking about who?
Man.
He's talking about Ish and Isha. Man and woman. Okay, somebody get 2 and 24.
It says, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh.
Oh, my God. Who is he talking about here? Now, does that sound like somebody that God was putting in dominion over somebody?
That'd be kind
of
crazy.
Does that sound like something that God trying to create a one unit, or was he trying to create somebody that was in a hierarchy position, trying to establish him over the woman that he just created in his own image, that he told was going to be called woman, that he brought to the man, that God brought her. God said, I made her, and I'm going to present her to you. And when you look at her, you're going to see your own reflection. You're going to see yourself, Adam. And when you look at her, you're going to say, ooh, this woman, and I'm going to call you woman. That is not what he was meaning. He did not mean that. He was telling God, because God said, I took her and I presented her to you. So he said, now I want you to see what you think about her, Adam. Woo, she's bone. She looked just like me. She got the, I can see Adam look. She made out of, she got the same flesh. She got bones like me.
Thank you, Jesus.
She gonna be called woman, Lord. All right. I got a companion now. Right. Somebody that's just for me. He said, I was naming all the animals, and I looked and I didn't see nobody for me. Adam was naming all the animals. You know what? Adam was so complete. God said, but I know you, it's not good for you to be by yourself. God looked and said, he needs somebody because he ain't complete yet. So God saw it. God said it wasn't good. So if God saw it and God said it wasn't good, and then God took and made and presented her, why did God put Adam as dominion over? Come on. So when it's taken out of context to be given other meanings that demean women by reducing them to the level of compliments, of docile conveniences, who were created just to improve the quality of a male's life. That's not what God created us for. Oh, I'm just going to improve the quality of a man's life. God just bought me so I can be the pretty side of him. He just bought me so I can have sexual relations with him, so I can birth the baby from him. That's all he created me for. Was a baby, to be a baby making machine. Cook, clean, wash clothes, and that's it. Eve received, along with Adam, the God-created ability and mandate to co-rule, to co-steward, and to co-dominion. Can you turn to the next slide? Yes, to co-rule, to co-steward, and co-dominion over creation, according to Genesis 1, 28 through 31. God told them both to what? Rule, have dominion, to be stewards, over what? All, he said over what? Now this is what I found amazing. What did he tell them to have dominion over? One another?
Creation.
Where did he use the word dominion? Where did he use the word dominion? Okay, he what now? So the only time he used dominion is when he told them to have dominion over what? Over everything else! Where do you read that he said have dominion over Eve? Anywhere in the book of creation, where did he say you have dominion over your wife? Not even in the scripture when we talked about Tosha did he say you have dominion. He did not. He was in referencing the consequence we're going to talk about right here. The statement of judgment for their disobedience in the garden in Genesis 3 and 14 through 19, okay, are descriptive ones of future realities, which involves supremacy, subjection, relationship between man and woman. Now, he put out and told them their consequences because of their disobedience. He never said, you have dominion over your wife. She said, her desires meant you're going to be turned away from God and you're going to turn to who? To your husband. He never once stated, even when he was giving them their consequence, you're going to have dominion over your wife. Never. Never one time did God say it. These statements are not creation mandates. When you read Genesis 1, 3, 14 through 19, those were not mandates by God. Okay? Rather, the relationship of mutuality, partnership, and equality that were displayed in the garden was now sadly marred by sin. In other words, God never intended for man to rule over one another ever. but to be mutual, to be in partnership, to be one, and be together. And be together. And that was marred by sin. Sin is what broke that in. Sin is what broke the communion. Sin is what broke partnership. Sin is what broke oneness. Sin. Sin. God didn't. God never wanted it to be. In the time, okay, and now this is not that, that, does anybody have any questions? Go back one, can't you? Go back. Okay, now, let me see. Anybody, stop right there. Now, does anybody have any questions on that? Want to make any statements on that? I want to bring that out. Okay, Brother Laquan. Elder Laquan.
Just more of a statement. If you look at Genesis 1:28, I mean, I never really noticed that it said, you know, God, and God blessed him. I always thought it just said, and God blessed him.
Never, yeah, that's what I'm saying.
When I never really sat out and actually looked at that. And I mean, it tells you. It says God blessed them, God said unto them, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish. I just feel like, you know, if God wanted men to have dominion over women, over women, he wouldn't have said, to them. He would be just speaking to Adam, and then he said, hey, you have dominion. And he would also mention, have dominion over the woman. He had her to that.
And I think God is smart. I think he's pretty smart enough. I think he's smarter than everybody on this earth to know if he wanted a man to have dominion, he would have stated that from the very beginning. He would have said, and you have dominion over everything of the fish, sea, fowl, air, and you have dominion over your wife. He know how to state that. He know how to allow me to know this is what, but he never stated that. So you, anybody else have any questions on the first Lee show statement? Church right now that's still living under that. Still living by that. And not realizing once you get the Holy Ghost, that sin repercussion, that penalty, you're no longer bound by that anymore.
I was thinking that with Eve, you know, she was named Eve because Eve means that she is going to be the mother of the human race. That's what I thought it was, you know, a man.
But it was still after she was named after sin.
Well, yeah, she was named after sin, but not to be dominated over.
No, that's not what we're saying. She was named after the fall. That means she was named after sin came in, but she was known as the mother of all living. Because that's what she was given a name, but it doesn't show a doctor. What that shows is that when they fell in sin, then she was given the name Eve. Because now she's gonna have to live under the penalty.
Now you're bringing me to this crazy question.
Yeah, penalty of sin.
Now this crazy question. Since she was named, when was Adam named? Because I know Adam means
it means mankind.
Adam was the first man.
It's still Adam.
But was it he Adam prior to the fall or after?
He was man, but he still was. It means ish. Ish means man.
Right.
Means human race. And when you look it up, it says a specific name. Okay. So it was when he said Adam, he was still representing the human race, but he still was named Adam.
She was saying that. I think you were trying to say Adam was named before.
I never paid attention.
Yeah, he still was called Adam. It just means, when you look at the Hebrew, it means ish, man, mankind. Yeah. What his name represents is his name, but it also represented all of mankind. Mm-hmm. Okay, all the human race.
Her name wasn't a curse.
Her husband was the one naming her. Exactly.
And, it was kind of showing that her will
serve
us, but she was wrong.
Her penalty.
And he didn't name her a bad name.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a repercussion. Her husband was
on the
face for
her.
You know.
Yeah.
Jonathan. I would say Adam's name didn't change just as a dog's name didn't change or a deer's name. What do you call it? When you got Ish and Isha, you're talking about the male part and then Isha the female part.
Yes.
You look at a deer, that's a deer. But if you want to talk more specific about what sex it is, you call a deer either a doe or a buck.
Yes.
So, you know, Adam's name didn't change. He was still the male version.
Exactly.
If you see a deer, you know, people would most likely say, think that he's a guy deer, unless he's
I just wonder if he named Adam versus man. That's all.
But that's not my question. I told you it was a pretty good question.
Yeah, that was a good question.
I don't want to hold up your lesson.
No, go ahead.
But my question is, I believe that Eve now, she was definitely present at the time of naming all their animals.
She was present.
Mm-hmm. There was no distinction because why would Adam name all of the
we're going to go there. Okay. Not tonight, but I want you to go ahead and finish.
Basically, God made them all on the sixth day.
Yes, he did.
You know, and then that's when Adam and Eve both numbered or named all of them. God pre-noted, you know, it's not good for a man to be alone because he's going to have a lot of work to do. He can't do it by himself. It won't be good for him to do it by himself. He's going to have help to do it. It wasn't in him. Adam,
even though
in God's image, he was still short of God.
Exactly. And that's why when God gave him woman, Isha, okay, it means Ezer, okay, which means help, rescuer, strength, power, okay, because he was going to now have the power to be able to name all these. He was not going to be able to have the strength to keep up the guard. He was not. And you know what? Now, I haven't got to that yet, but I'm getting on. Me and my husband going to get on. Apostle G going to get on into that. Because that was something else that God brought. And me and my husband was talking about that a while ago. I said Eve was there.
She was.
And I can't nobody tell me she wasn't. She was there. Just because God did not, they were not distinguished at that time. It was Ish and Isha. They were man, Adam. When he said Adam, he meant woman. Ish and Isha, same root word, Adam. He had to name the woman because they were both known as Adam.
Right.
He only distinguished Ish and Isha to distinguish gender.
Exactly.
That was it. So when he said Adam, both of their names were Adam. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
I'm about to answer your question.
Mm-hmm.
Both of their names were called Adam. So after the fall, she could no longer be conceived. They had to be distinguished. So she was given the name Eve. Adam was the specific name. And Doug, you look at in the comprehensive Arabic lexicon, in the Syriac dialect, it says personal name. Even though it represented represented human mankind, Adam was still a definitive name that represented somebody. It represented the man, Ish, and it represented the woman, Isha. But after the fall, she had to be distinguished with her own name. That's why she was given the name Eve, to represent mother of all living. Okay, she had to be, because now sin had broken the communion. Sin had broken the oneness. So now he said, now I name her Eve, because she's going to be the mother of all living. We're no longer one, because we're not one with God. We're not one with each other. It's broken, and so now she has to be distinguished by that. Okay, go.
That right there, I think people, when you read the Genesis, the first week of creation, that whole 7 days, people get confused with timeline.
Yeah, they do.
Well, they say, okay, we're doing those 6 days he made out, then he rested, and then they think a couple of months later.
It don't make sense.
That's how these little cartoons, they make it like that. Mm-hmm. Adam, he was by himself, God went on, and he named all the animals, and suddenly Adam was lonely and alone. But God, on the sixth day, like you said, raised clarity, he made
she was there.
The same time. It wasn't months later or, you know, the time span. She was made within that first, that six, seven. Why would God
she was make? Great. She was made.
Why would God make made. Adam and then rest? It's in the same. He rested.
He didn't rest. He made her the.
Yes. And that's what that was.
Yeah, you know, that's our human philosophy.
Use commas.
Yes.
Let me share something with you. That is our human thinking, right? Yeah. We're trying to rationalize it just like they try to rationalize three gods.
It's because they said Ish is human, and he made the...
No, Ish means man. Isha means woman. Yeah. Adam means mankind. It was a definitive name given to both of them. Mm-hmm. But that meant human race, mankind, people, man, okay? That's what Adam means. So it was a definitive name. It was a name that was given to both of them. But after the fall, she had to be named separately.
Right.
So Isha means man, Ish means man, Isha means woman. Mm-hmm. What he did there was to show a distinction in gender only. Okay?
Right.
So anybody has any more questions on that? Any comments on that? Anybody have any questions, comments? Okay. And we'll go with anything else next. So I want to go real quickly. I want to begin this 8:31 and kind of hit a little bit into what kind of brought. I want to kind of lay that foundation so we get understanding of where it brings us at in ministry as a husband and wife team, as women, where Jesus thought of women. I haven't got to what Paul thought of women yet, and how to show you the distinction of why God never meant for it to be a hierarchy. He always meant for it to be one, because in order for the body of Christ to be one, we all have to work together. Jonathan? Oh, okay. All have to work together. So this brings me up to my next slide, women in ministry. And we're going to look at the view of how Jesus thought and what he thought, and why he came and why he did what he did. At Calvary, did he come and die on Calvary just to redeem a man?
No,
he didn't. He redeemed everybody. Man, woman, child, everybody. Okay? In the time of Jesus' ministry, women were usually regarded as subordinate and inferior in virtually every area of life. What brought that about?
Sin.
This is the penalty. Okay? They were to remain at home. Remember, they took and they defined, this was her penalty. To be good wives and mothers, and to take part, and to take no part in public discourse or education. We couldn't even be educated back then. Now, do you think that was the will of God?
No.
Or was that a penalty that we were paying for our sin?
Right.
Jesus, by his teaching and actions, affirmed the worth and value of women as persons to be included along with men within God's love and service. So God loved us just like he did Ish, the man, and he included us in service. in the house of God. Okay? Jesus challenged sexual put downs of women. Kendrick, are you with me? Okay. Jesus reached out to women who were rejected, because they were back in the back then in a predominantly male-oriented society, a patriarchal society where men dominated, women were considered subjugated and subordinate. They couldn't learn, they couldn't read, they couldn't do work, they couldn't do anything. They were like slaves. Okay? They were arranged marriages, they arranged who you married, they told you who you was gonna marry. Men could commit adultery, they could commit adultery, and nothing would happen to them. If a woman committed adultery, she was stoned to death, but it was all right for a man to commit adultery. Was that of the Lord?
No,
that wasn't. That wasn't. So Jesus came, and when he redeemed man, just like Elder Alicia said, he came to redeem us from the penalty of sin. Everybody, woman and man. And he came to the rejected women. In spite of the laws regarding uncleanness, Jesus allowed who to touch it?
Right.
A woman with a 12-year menstrual issue problem touching. Now, in the law back in that day, it was considered you were to be unclean to let somebody touch you who had a disease. But here you have the high priest, the Lord of Lords, King of Kings, that said, come on and touch me because I'm not bound by man's laws. I'm not bound by man's traditions. I'm not bound by you. I came to break the penalty of sin that you have been kept in. Woman, you've been rejected. You've been kicked aside. You've been abused, all because you had a disease in your body that you could not fix. And because of that, they have kicked you to the curb and forgot all about you. But God said, I came back so that you can be redeemed. Okay? He commended her when she touched his garment for her faith. In Mark 5:25-34. He commended her. Where the law said you need to reject her, she should have been punished. God said, I commend you for your faith. Jesus permitted a sinful woman to anoint and kiss his feet in Luke 7:36-50. She was sinful. They said, ooh, who is she? She was a what? She was a prostitute. They said, oh my God, you let her touch you. You let her kiss you. He said, yes, I am. Because I'm not bound by man's laws. I'm not bound by the rules that govern your earth, that govern this land. I'm bound by the laws of the word.
Right.
So Jesus permitted a sinful woman to kiss, touch, and anoint his feet. He offered redemption directly to women who were known as what? Adulteresses. In John, he said, you without sin cast the first stone. He said, now if you ain't got some in your closet, then I suggest you turn on around and walk away. And I believe when he got down in the dirt and he started writing, he started saying, okay, Samuel, now I saw this last night.
Mm-hmm.
He turned around. Okay, John, I saw this last night.
Right.
And he turned around. And he just started writing each one of you without sin. Look, I saw this last night. He probably let them know, I know what you did, so how you gonna condemn her? And all of them turned around and walked away. He offered redemption directly to her. And in the New Testament, responsible teachers were not to teach women. They were told, if you're a responsible teacher, you do not teach women. Women are not considered worthy to be taught. Nevertheless, Jesus taught women and included them in his group of committed disciples.
Right.
Come on now.
Yes.
Come on now. Now, they said Eve was to be under subjection and subordinate to the husband. She was a slave to him, and she was this to him, and God, and from that point on, every woman paid the price, the penalty of the fall. But Jesus came to do what? Tear that down. He taught Mary of Bethany and commended her learning to her sister who was carried about with menial tasks in Luke Mary fell at the foot of who? Jesus. And she sat at his feet and listened to him teach, to the disciples who were there. The men were there. They were all sitting together learning. And Jesus looked at her sister and said, Martha, you're carried and covered away with all these different things, but Mary chooses the better part. She chooses to be under my feet, in my feet, learning. It was the Samaritan woman that Jesus made his most explicit affirmation that he was the what? The Messiah, and shared with her his basic mission according to John 4:4-42. Did he not tell her? He said, who, the one that you're giving water to, how you, the water I'm giving you, you ain't gonna thirst no more. Right. Yeah, you ain't gonna need this type of water. Right. And he told her all the husbands she had. And she said, oh my God, and she ran up to the town and did what? And evangelized it and began to tell them, oh, you need to come and see a man who told me, oh my God, who said I would never thirst again. And she declared he was the Messiah. According to Luke 8:1-3, many women were in Jesus' band of traveling disciples. Now, if it was meant for a woman to be subjugated, to be in submission, a man to be dominated, why did Jesus have so many women disciples along with the men? According to Luke 8:1-3, many women were in Jesus' band of traveling disciples. These same women were present at the crucifixion and burial and on resurrection morning, according to Luke 23:49-56, and Luke 24:1. Okay? If somebody could give me one of those scriptures, we're going to be close. I'm going to go to one more slide because I got a couple more slides. This is running time, but Luke 23:49. Whoever has it, just read it. Luke 23.
And all his acquaintance and the woman that followed him from Galilee stood afar off, beholding these things.
Amen. It says, and all his acquaintance and the women that followed him from Galilee stood afar off, beholding these things. And then somebody get me Luke 55:56.
Same chapter. And the women also which came with him from Galilee followed after and beheld the sepulchre and how his body was laid. And they returned and prepared spices and ointments and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment.
Okay, and the notes said, what? Women. See how easy it is for us to say woman?
Yeah.
If you really don't pay attention to the scriptures and not notice women, he's saying there's women. Now somebody give Luke 24:1.
Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sculpture, bringing the spices which they prepared, and certain others with them.
Okay, amen. So we see that these were what? These were his disciples, and they were what? Were they only men?
Nope.
No, they weren't. They were pupils. They were students that were learning at the foot of Jesus along with their counterpart, their men counterpart. Jesus, and can you go to the next one? Jesus affirmed the value of committed discipleship and obedience to God even over the natural and valued role of a mother. He said, Joe, discipleship and your obedience to God is valued over your natural role of a mother. He said, my mother and my brothers are those who hear God's word and put it into practice, according to Luke 8:21. And then it says, blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Blessed are those. Did he say man? Woman? He said who? That means who?
Her mother.
That be anybody, anyone, rather than his own mother. In Luke 11:28, the woman that Jesus included became the proclaimed, the women that Jesus included became the proclaimers as Savior and risen Lord. The Samaritan woman, which we just talked about, she was responsible for evangelizing her home, for evangelizing the town. She went and told him about the Messiah, someone that was that had told her all these things. Why? She told him, he's God. I know he is. Why? Because Jesus was trying to affirm, we are no longer under the penalty. We are helpers together. Go one more slide, Kendrick. It says all the gospels show that it was Jesus' women, disciples, who were the first to declare the message of Jesus' resurrection, central to the gospel of the early church. Among Jesus' disciples, we know of 17 men by name, okay? The 12 was Joseph, Justus, Matthias, according to Acts 1:23, Lazarus, Nicodemus, and Joseph of Arimathea. What is not so often noted, though, is that we also know women by name from among his circle of devoted disciples as well, okay? Mary, his own mother, the mother of who? Jesus. Mary Magdalene, the other Mary, is what the Bible says. Mary of Bethany, Joanna, Suanna, and Salome. Now, these were all disciples, students, pupils, that learned at the foot of Jesus along with their male counterpart, their brother in the gospel, okay? When God created male and female, Ish and Isha, he created us to do what? To work together in the home, to work together in the church, to work together to do what? Spread the gospel. Okay, I'm gonna stop right here. To spread the gospel. And kids, you can turn it off. To spread the gospel. He created us. He never intended for us to dominate, to rule, to be subjugated to one another. He never intended for anybody to be put in slavery. That was never God's intention. Yeah. God's intention was always for us to work as one, to be one in his sight. Because he already knew we're gonna be battling fighting against a foe that we were not equipped to beat, let alone try to fight him alone. Okay? But God equipped us, and then he equipped us with help. One another. He equipped us with help with one another. So when Jesus included the women in ministry, when he started in the beginning with man and woman, he was creating a what? A team. God already knew what was getting ready to happen. He wasn't done. He saw it all. He knows our ending from our beginning and our beginning from our end. So he saw, he knew. So he gave Adam some what? Some help. To help him in the garden. And guess what? To help him in this walk we call life. Okay? Because when you're by yourself, it's hard. It's hard to resist temptation. When a man ain't married, when a woman ain't married, it's hard to resist temptation. It is. It's harder. But when you got somebody standing next to you to say, look, they can do what? They can support you when you what? When you're weak. Okay? And the other one is what? Strong. He said, let the strong bear the what?
Infirmities of the weak.
Infirmities of the weak. Now, if you're by yourself, you can't, how can you bear anything? Who gonna bear it? Don't say, well, Jesus will. Well, yeah, he will, but still, in the physical, you're still by yourself. God said, I'm gonna give you some help. God never intended for divorce. God never intended for any of what's happening right now in this world. But it was all the repercussions of sin. Sin. And do you not understand that if you still live, and we got people in the church right now that still holding, I'm not going to say they hold, because you can't hold nobody unless they let you hold. So they're not holding anybody. They're there because they still want to be there and refuse to go against what is being taught and stand up for what's right. But you got people in the church that's still bound under the penalty, the old covenant. And they're still teaching you bound by this, you bound by that, you supposed to do this, you supposed to obey me, you supposed to have your desires to me. Your desires, everybody's desires should be toward the Lord. And if it hadn't been toward the Lord, we would have never been in this mess. But we turned away from the Lord. And we turn our hearts away from God. And as a repercussion of that, we now find ourselves in the position that we find ourselves in a lot of time, in the church and outside of the church. Amen. Amen. Did we help somebody here tonight? I didn't get to finish out a whole bunch for it. Praise God. Anybody have any questions from the little bit we just, I got a whole bunch more I got to cover, but Elder Darnell.
Well, it's more of a statement because, like, for me, I'm kind of a simple guy. I like to make things literal to help me understand it. If you think about the word support and you think about a building, like even in this church right here, this big beam right here is a support beam, mm-hmm. and it helps this building stand. But that don't mean that the support is bigger than the building, because without the building, all you have is just a beam. And then all you have is a support beam, and without the support beam, you don't really have a building. So neither one of them is greater than the other. It's just that they both need each other, and that's a great way to think about support, because that support beam is what helps hold this building up.
Exactly.
Neither one is greater than the other. It's just one help the other.
Exactly. And that's just that, to put it simple like that, that's what it believes. Support don't mean the support that they're trying to put it. Well, she's supporting, that means she's less than him.
Less than, yeah.
No. Because what the Ephesians say in the beginning, all the parts are fitly joined together. So without the kneecap, you're not going to have a knee. Okay? And without the leg, you're not going to be able to have a foot and ankle. Okay? So, I mean, because you can't walk, Bobby, you ain't got no kneecap, you can't walk with your leg to your hip. Or your leg to your back. Okay? So it's all together working for the good, the same purpose, the same goal. Everybody's striving for the same thing. We're looking toward what heaven. Because we in the end, everybody's got to make what heaven their own. And that's the goal. That's the whole purpose. So we're out evangelizing, witnessing, telling people, and doing. And normally when I go teach a preacher, my husband go teach the preacher, I need his support. He needs my support. Because we help balance each other out. We help each other. Praise God. So it's the same way. It's the same way in the kingdom. Praise God. Anybody else have any questions, any comments, anything they want to add to before we close? Do you have anything?
Just know it's a foundation for focus on the family. That's what it's all about. Getting that foundational understanding of how God set it up prior to sin. Because that's the state that God wants us in.
Amen. Amen. He wants us in the state of in the glory. That was his whole design. He came to bring us back to what?
Back to the
place we were in the beginning. The one we were created in his image. Where we weren't marred with sin. That's what he came back to do, to reconcile us back to himself. Okay? That's what he did. And if he's reconciling us back to himself, why are we still in the penalty of sin? Okay? So, Father, we're going to dismiss. We can stand as we dismiss. We kind of running late, 8:52, but praise God. Amen. How many get something out of the lesson? Sometimes we just need to be taught. We just need to be taught. We need to look so we can get glean. We need to break down words. We need to get an understanding. With all your getting, get an understanding. Because that is the key. That's why so many people are tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. And we have to know what God